Hey, hello everybody, welcome back to another 3D Hangout. I'm Noed, designer here at Adafruit, and joining me every week is Mr. Pedro.
What's going on, everybody? I'm Pedro Ruiz, creative tech here at Adafruit, and every week we come to share 3D printed projects featuring electronics from Adafruit.
That's right, this is where we combine 3D printing and DIY electronics to make inspirational projects. Let's start off the show with saying hello to everybody in the chat room. Hello! Thank you for joining us today. We are live streaming. It is episode 121 on a Wednesday. The show is now on Wednesdays, for those of you who don't know yet. It used to be on a Thursday, but now it's on Wednesdays. Awesome.
What's up, everybody in the chat room? Giving a shout out to a writer, Matthew, Jim the Milkman.
Jim the Milkman. Winner for coolest name.
And then over on Facebook, we're streaming on Facebook? As well.
Really?
Check us out there.
We are on Facebook as well.
Whoa.
Yeah. I can only do so many clicking to like fix this thing.
And Matthew and Ronald, you all get shout outs.
Hello everybody.
This week's discount code is NeoMinis.
Yeah, so today's discount code is NeoMinis, which sounds like a breakfast cereal that I would definitely like to eat. Yeah.
You should definitely make some circuit themed cereal.
Sure. So, hey guys, over on YouTube, we just released our project video, so check that out if you haven't already.
So, the past 2 weeks, I've been showing off this really cool project, super slim NeoPixel LED bracelet.
Check it out. If you go to learn.adafruit.com, you can find the guide for this week's project. The video is up on YouTube, and we'll probably embed that in the guide after the show, because there's so many things to do.
Whoops.
So the parts used in this project are pretty simple. We're using the Adafruit Trinket, the little small microcontroller. We're using mini, skinny NeoPixel strips. These are sort of new-ish, and we're going to show you guys sort of compare them to the older NeoPixel strips. So they're basically thinner, and they're smaller. They're not like any less of like brightness or anything. They're just a smaller form factor, which makes it easy to embed in lots of different small projects like this one. We're using a pretty small battery as well. We're using a 150 milliamp battery, an extension cable, a slide switch, and a micro USB jack to recharge the battery. So there's the parts. We'll also need a magnet and a paper clip because crafts. Cool. So the circuit diagram is actually pretty universal for all sorts of different projects. And the cool thing about this one is it takes NeoPixel strips as kind of, they're designed to be cut so you can make custom size strips. So we cut these up into four strips. Each strip has five LEDs. And you can kind of make your own grid this way. So you can make this flexible grid because NeoPixels have flexible PCBs. So that's pretty cool. You can curve it around surfaces just like this week's project. So really simple to put together. And because it's such a tight fit inside the enclosure, we didn't use the Trinket LiPo backpack, which allows you to recharge the battery over the USB port on the Adafruit Trinket. So you do have to kind of take it out. But it's one of those compromises that you make when you're making a really small project. And the code used in the project is actually from GitHub, GitHub user Haras B. So you can check him out. This is an awesome piece of code. It's called the Gemma Hoop Animator. I guess it was originally made for the Gemma. But it does some really nice random sort of sparkly code, which is pretty awesome, and it kind of cycles through different things. So you can check that out. If you're looking for some nice new NeoPixel animations, check out that code. It's pretty awesome. As far as 3D printing goes, we have all the parts for you here, and they can print without any support material. We have most of the slice settings set up, but the main thing you want to do with this is to make sure that your part has just perimeters and no infill. So there's various ways to do that in your slicers, specifically in Simplify 3D. There's an option just to say print thin parameters, and that's it. So that's cool. All right, so I think with that, I want to go ahead and show people the part over the head and talk about it.
So here it is one more time. We showed this off a couple times last week. This is the smallest form factor that I could get all these electronics in here. It's very tight for space, but you're able to fit in both the new Trinket as well as the older one that has the mini USB jack on there. It's exposed, so it's easy to plug up into your port, change up the code, slide switch right on the side here, just slides right in there. And then the battery, we've got a couple of questions every time that we show this off. No, the battery is not being bent in there.
Bent? Bending a LiPo battery is not such a good idea.
Yeah, so if you take a look at the shape, it's actually an ellipse, so it's not quite a true circle. That is what's given it that enough room, so you can just slide that right in there. And there is actually a piece taken out. You can kind of see it right here. Actually, it's more better if you just jump into the CAD for that. You can take a look at the wall thicknesses for that. Enough so
we're jumping around here.
I can fit in there.
Does that work for you guys? Can you see that? I can't tell because I'll have a tunnel. It doesn't matter. Maybe it's working. All right, so here's the CAD. Here's Infusion 360. We do have the file for you so you guys can download it. It is a public shared document. And here's what Pedro's referring to. There are sort of variable thicknesses inside the walls. So if you zoom in all the way here, you can see that there's a little bit more material cut. Can you you're still catching up, huh?
Yeah.
All right, well, I hope it works. Yeah, it's working. Cool. All right, so you can notice that the thickness, for the most part, I can do a quick little measurement by clicking on one face, holding down shift, and then clicking on the second face. And then on the bottom here, it says the minimum distance between those two. So in this case, it's the thickness. So it's 1.4 millimeters thick. And then if you go to the thinner part, you can see that's actually 1 millimeter thick. And that translates to one parameter, like one wall.
Which is just enough to be able to fit that in there.
Yeah. So you can fit the battery right here. And then in this area where there's a cutout, that's where the micro USB port will be for the trinket. So you can reprogram it. And that's kind of it there. Did you want to pull out anything else? I got a cool tip for this little area here.
Yeah, so I didn't end up needing any supports for the overhangs on the hinge here. So but you can optimize this just a little bit more by using some drafts.
Yeah, so here is the sort of hinge that works, right? And as a part of a hinge, you added an end stopper, which is this little piece of geometry here that sticks out. Yeah, and so that just kind of...
It just limits it when you open it up. It's not going to bend or kink the wires that are passing through there.
Yeah.
Nice little design touch there.
Yeah. Cool.
So continue with the draft so you can take a look at how to print this with absolutely no overhangs if you don't have a nice fan to cool it down.
So if you're printing this in this orientation with this part being the bottom of the bed and then printing upwards, you're going to run into a little bit of an overhang issue. Some printers have really nice active cooling, which will kind of combat that, no problem. But if you want to be really, really kind of secure to it and make it nice, we can add draft. So under Modify inside Fusion 360, there's this thing called Draft. And if you roll over anything on Fusion, it'll tell you what it kind of does. And just by kind of looking at the picture, you can see like, oh, okay, it kind of gives you a drafted angle for a given surface. But the way it works is a little bit backwards. So we want to affect this guy, but we actually want to select this guy here. And I'll show you why in a second. So we select this as the plane, and then we select the face that we want. It's a little bit backwards to me, but that's the way Fusion made it. So now I have this little handle which I can adjust it. And I think 30 is just fine. You could do a chamfer, but the chamfer only does 45 degrees. We could go lower, like 30 or even 25. Mm-hmm. But I'm going to go with 30. So now we have this really nice kind of angle, drafted angle, where our printer should be able to catch that in our slicer so we don't have to worry about overhangs, because it's a nice sort of degree where it can catch itself here. And then you can also do another draft to this guy over here to kind of fix it a little bit. Yeah, to sort of match it. But again, you have to kind of work backwards with it. So again, when I select draft, I select the plane of which I want to kind of make the draft go on. So I want this plane and then this face. That's the face that we're going to affect. And then I'm going to go down and then just follow that same
degree.
Yeah, so it's 30, and I'll hit enter. Now if we bring back the 2, you can see we got this cool, perfectly lined up thing there.
You're gonna have to do it to the bottom as well because you do have an overhang on that.
Oh wow, that's funny. Yeah, I would have to go this way.
Yep.
Yeah.
But the reason I didn't do that was because I didn't want to, because there is gonna be less material on there that might make it a little less durable in terms of opening and closing, but again, you could also just use supports to fill that in. Should work just fine.
Yep, that's just a quick tip to let you guys know. If you want to avoid supports and things like that, you totally can. Let's bring this into Simplify 3D.
I just opened it up without.
Oh, yeah.
Just to save time on it.
Like this?
So the cool thing about this project is this should fit on the smallest 3D printer.
Yeah.
Which is why we didn't combine it or do like a print-in-place hinge. Wanted to make sure that it was nice and durable and that it fit on even the smallest printers. So here we have the bed size for a PrinterBot Play, which is about 100 by 100 millimeters in size.
Take a look at that overhang.
Print perfectly.
Yay, overhangs. So you can see here that as the...
Although on the PrinterBot Play, it'll play nice with the overhangs.
Yeah, most of them will. I mean, there are still overhangs that you don't have to worry about, like this little cutout here. Because it's a bridge, it kind of catches itself. If we didn't have one here, it just doesn't have anything to catch onto. Yeah. This one has these little holes here, actually indentations for installing magnets, which we will talk about in a second here. Those magnets are pretty nifty.
And you don't need any supports inside of those, just because the bridging for that is so small that it should be able to catch it, even if you don't have a fan on your printer.
Yeah.
So one other thing we want to make sure that we get the point across in terms of printing is that we want to make sure that the tool path for this is completely optimized. We don't want any zigzagging going on between the walls.
Yeah, so under the advanced tab in Simplify 3D, there's a thing called thin wall behavior. You have two options here. Normally you have this allow gap fill when necessary. So what that's going to do is it's going to give you infill where you kind of don't need it. It's good for strong parts, but this kind of doesn't need it. So take a look at the inside of these walls. You see these little zigzags and stuff? That's going to add thickness to your part ever so slightly. Is that right?
Oh, yeah. And it's going to take up a little bit more time just because the printer's not going, you know, in a nice straight curve fashion. It's sitting there zigzagging as it's going across.
Right.
And it could give you artifacts on the outside. It'll
definitely
mess
stuff,
with
the
diffusion on the walls between them.
It would make it kind of
less transparent.
So let's go ahead and turn that option off and set it to thin wall only.
So the default option is to have it with the allow gap fill.
Right. Yes. I think
so
it
you
is.
Wanna switch over.
Now let's take a look. It's in a book. There
you
go.
See how now it's completely optimized. It's not filling in. And what that's actually doing is giving you some space so that you can actually, gives you like some tolerances that, built into it.
Yeah,
so
and you
the
can
walls are able
squeeze
to,
the walls, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
Which you kind of want for this because you want it to have like this grippy fit.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So there's a tip for you, thin wall parameters for the win.
Keep that on.
Yeah, keep that on for these parts. What else was I going to say? I was going to say something else. Yeah. I don't remember. It's something good, I know. Maybe it'll come back to me. But anyway, that's kind of... No, it was about the parts and maybe something regarding the same... Oh, it saves you 10 minutes. I looked. It's in 58 minutes, and now it's 47 minutes.
Yeah, cool.
So 10 minutes just to make those little zigzags. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a waste, isn't it?
Yeah.
All right.
And again, it's going to give give you all those artifacts that you may not
like
on there.
Definitely could.
Moving on to the magnets that we used in the
back to the tunnel into
enclosure there. My new favorite type of magnet. Usually we use the bigger one, bigger cylinders that we have. We've used these little thin ones, but the strength, the pull strength on it was pretty low, just because of the surface area of it. Because this is has a nice longer surface area, it's able to.
What are these magnets?
A lot more stronger. So we got these over at K and J. These are 1/8 by 1/4 N42.
They're linked in the guide, so if you want to get these magnets exactly, check out the guide link.
I'm going to be using these in a lot more projects just because we're able to get them so thin. I didn't want to increase the thickness for the sides here to, you know, just fit these guys in there. You can see that definitely would have gone outside the walls.
What is it
and
called?
They weren't as strong.
The type of magnetization that it has is something special, diametric?
Yep. So they are straight down vertically where they're polarized.
Yeah.
And in the guide, you can visually see, and on their website too, it has a little graphic demonstrating where the north and south poles are.
Cool.
and
these have some lot of pull strength. We have some other small magnets that don't have as enough of a pull strength, and these have a very strong pull strength. One thing you did was you added, you were planning to use 3 magnets per side, but they were so strong that you only needed 2.
Yeah, I have another slot in there for another one, but it actually ends up saving material, so that's always good. So the way that this is completely hollowed out is super optimized. There's no wasted material. This whole design, very cool.
Okay.
Another thing we wanted to talk about was the type of battery that we're using. We're using the 150. When I started out, I was going to use the 100 milliamp hour just because it was thinner, smaller, but it's actually a little bit taller, which would have, because when you're measuring things out with your battery, you always want to give more size to the top here because of the bending of the wire. So that's why it may look like it, you know, would fit in there, but it would have to increase it vertically for it to fit in there. And the 150 is perfect because you're able to add the size of the wire when you bend that over like that. And you can see you have plenty of room in there. And another thing that I like about this design is you don't have to shorten any of the cables. Anytime we have to do that to fit things inside of a tiny enclosure, I'm always worried with people starting out, cutting wires on a LiPo battery, because that can be pretty dangerous.
One thing you do if you're cutting a LiPo battery, don't cut both of the wires at the same time. I did that once, and I shorted the battery, and I could have died. Thankfully, I didn't. But you cut one wire at a time. Anyway, that's another tip for a different story. Mm-hmm. So what did you use to extend the battery?
So the way this is all being connected together is our favorite battery connection setup using a female JST connection. So that's
the way. It's called the JST extension cable. So it's made to kind of extend your JST batteries, but we use it to make a slide switch adapter. Mm-hmm. So combine this with a slide switch and you can power the circuit on and off, because there isn't a power button on the trinket itself. It's so minimal. It's very kind of bare bones. So you kind of have to keep adding these components to it. So the cool thing is with the slide switch, you wire it in line with the ground cable to the JST connector. So you don't actually have to modify or cut the cable from the battery. I think we can show that in the assembly page. Is that right?
Yeah.
Get a better look at that. A lot of the assembly requires sort of kind of assembling while you're building it. You can't just solder all of the connections and then put it in the enclosure. It's not the way it works. You have to thread wires through certain areas in order to then solder it to the component.
Case being, it can be a little bit more challenging, but
it is a bit of a challenge, but it gives you that idea of like, oh wow, cool. I have to kind of assemble while I'm building and think about these steps linearly, right? Mm-hmm. So that's cool. So the first part of the assembly is, of course, making the grid, which really kind of tests your fine motor skills, because these wires have to be really, really short in order to fit inside the enclosure. So that right there in itself gives you good practice on fine-tuning wires. And the best tool to use to do that is kind of tweezers, because your fingers are kind of bigger than the wires in a sense, right? Mm-hmm. So that's a good tip.
And they're so short, you want to hold the wires so you don't burn your fingers.
Yeah, exactly. You get much more fine motor control when you're using a tool like a tweezer. Mm-hmm. So that and in combination with our favorite flush snips that we have. Do you want to show them off? Or?
Way over on the overhead.
Yeah, I can go to the overhead real quick. Hey, what tools do you like? What tools are...
Yeah, so this is sort of a universal sort of tool. It's super handy for 3D print parts. This is what I use to get rid of all of the support materials and when I need to chop up like sharp corners or any oozing that is occurring on parts. First thing that I grab. We have these everywhere, like in every station, every floor of the house. I know. It's one of those.
Right. And then these guys.
And then our ESD... tweezers, perfect for grabbing all the little tiny wires, for getting things into crevices, and of course when your printer is purging filament, great for grabbing that out of the way.
Yeah.
And a little chopstick cheater right there too.
Alright, back to the assembly. So you do have to kind of install parts before soldering them into the case to gauge how long the connections need to be. So here in the guide, we kind of show you, all right, put the trinket here and then figure out how long this needs to be. So variable lengths for all the connections, of course.
Mm-hmm.
And then once you get your wire soldered into the strip, you kind of have to thread that through the hinge. And that's kind of how we're able to connect the two pieces together. Through that hinge, you have the nice opening to support those three wires. I don't think any thicker wires, too. Like, it's kind of essential to have 30-gauge wire in this project.
Anything
thicker might not really fit, work yeah. and fit. Yeah, and then just kind of stuffing the thing in, you have to kind of be careful with it. Again, another good use of the tweezers is you're able to kind of pack this sheathing into the case.
So if you jump back over to the overhead, that is one thing I just forgot to talk about. The back of it is, we use it like a flathead, so yeah. for a lot of the production, for grabbing the quick plates off of cameras, I just use the back of this, but it's also handy for stuffing the sheathing that is that I left on for the LEDs. So I'm just using it to pack it in there, mm-hmm. the sides,
yeah.
Because it's going to get pretty crammed in here.
Yeah. Speaking of LEDs, let's show them the mini Neos.
So these are the original ones, and then we have the skinny mini. So if you guys have had these lying around, you know, thought, oh, there's no reason for me to get the skinnier ones. If you want to work on a smaller project, these are definitely recommended just because they are half the size of the original.
Yeah. 10 millimeter versus 5.
Yeah. So they're the same thickness, but half the, I guess, the height of it?
Width.
Width.
Mm-hmm. The length is how long it is, and the thickness is how thick it is. So they're different. You know, they look different. The bigger one is a 144 high density neopixel mm-hmm. strip. The way we kind of rank them is by low, medium, and high density. Low being 30 pixels per millimeter.
Mm-hmm.
Medium is 60, which is this one here. This mm-hmm. one's a 60.
Yeah.
And that has 60 pixels per meter.
And the reason why we didn't go with the high density one is for battery life, but
yeah, 144 per meter. That's quite a bit.
Drain it pretty quick.
Yeah. So there's a total of 20 neopixels in the bracelet.
Mm-hmm.
And because it's a grid, you can kind of make letters too so using the neopixel
you
matrix.
You could
definitely spell out names and stuff, I believe. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. Right now we're just running the Gemma animation hoop, which does the super cool sparkles. But you could definitely do words, spell your name or something.
Mm-hmm.
So that's rad.
And then one thing you want to make sure that you do when you're cutting these is to cut completely in the middle of it. You don't want to be off to one side because it is going to be it's going to make it harder to solder onto these if you want to use that other part in a future project.
I've messed one up before and I had to make a sacrificial pixel where I had to kind of cut one off.
Yeah,
I actually did it with the energy sword. Like, the one side had like 43 and the other one had 42.
Ah.
So it's like, oops.
Yeah. And they are a little bit more challenging on the 144, but it can be done. Yeah.
Those pads are so tiny. Let me see if I can focus here.
Let's see.
Zip.
Yeah, you get like such little room to cut that.
That's where you kind of want a sacrificial pixel.
Yeah. Because
you could do it, but you have such small area.
It's a challenge, huh?
You have like 200 microns to work with. That's plenty. Cool.
Yeah. Okay, jumping back into the guide.
Yeah.
We continue on to the next section, which is fitting the JST extension cable inside there.
Sure. Measure first.
Mm-hmm.
Measure twice, cut once.
And while we're there, one of the things that I wasn't able to fit into the project just because of time constraints is you are able to add a charge circuit on there.
Oh my goodness. Check this little charge circuit.
You are going to have to do some hacking, though, to fit it in there just because of the size of the JST connector on there.
Yeah.
So the trick that you can do is to use your handy flush cutters.
One of these parts. Let's see what happens.
Oh yeah, you would need a cutout part, just like that, to fit it in. Which is gonna suck because the cable for the battery is gonna come out of here, and then you can't really bend that too much.
Mm-hmm.
So that really isn't gonna work. What you're gonna have to do is take your flush snips and completely cut off the JST connection on there until you're left with just this.
Let's bring that in all the way as closer.
right? Mm-hmm. Take a look at that little guy.
So it cuts pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, you could solder another. We sell, you can get a JST connector and then put it back on if you want. But you see the plus and the minus? Those are the power pads. So you can wire in the extension cable into that. And that way, yeah, that little guy there. That way you have you know, a thinner circuit so that you can recharge the battery.
Mm-hmm. So what you're trying to do is lower the height, the clearance for that. As you can see there, if this was off into the side like that,
that'd be cool.
You have enough room inside of the enclosure here to fit that in. So this slides in quite nicely like that. And then you'd have to add another cutout for this so that the JST connection could fit inside there.
Right.
Because as it is right now, it's not going to fit in there because of that one perimeter.
Not only is it a thin enclosure, it's curved.
That too, yeah.
It's a challenge, man.
So it'd just go right next to it, and the wires would go over to the slide switch, and you'd have it would recharge just by plugging in the trinket. But that is, a mod you could add on to yourself if you want to build one of these and have it easily charge.
Cool.
Nice little tip there.
Yep. But we left it out of the
Actually, we didn't know if this would cut clean until last night. We were practicing for the show. Just grabbed one, started snipping it off. I was going to unsolder it, which would be a little bit more harder to do. This is a lot more quicker.
That's the way to go.
Instant gratification to see that, yeah, you can reroute the JST connection on that. It's a nice little tip there.
Yeah, that's great. I think it's like $7 or so, a little bit.
Yeah, but definitely worth it though.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because that is, as it is right now, you are going to have to remove
the cover
on this, take it out, charge it. Which if you're like at a convention or something like that, it's not too bad because you're not going to have any time to charge while you're on like on a floor or anything
just
like that.
Just
swap out the battery. So that's sort of what I had in mind. And then reasoning behind why I did not make this a print in place hinge, everybody has access to paper clips. So we're using the larger ones, not like the smaller
standard size
paper clip. And it works excellent as a hinge. The only tip is to make sure you bend the ends so that it's actually, sort of pushing itself on the side so it doesn't just flop right out. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the only tip for that. And cut it shorter than it is so that then you can push it and sort of jam it in there with a pair of tweezers.
Mm.
Get it nice and embedded inside there.
Cool.
And I think that's pretty much it.
Yeah.
Any
highlights?
Type of filament that we decided to go with was the natural white PLA, because in tests that we've done in the past, it is what created the most softest diffusion.
Yeah. You get a lot of sort of...
It'll be more sharper if you try the translucent filament. And if you use just plain white pigment filament, the pigment's actually going to block out the lights, and it's actually going to make it look a little yellow, and it actually won't diffuse as nice. It'll actually block the color.
Yeah.
What are you going to say?
That's it. You've said it all. I don't like transparent diffusers because
sometimes
they
it looks
just
pretty
kind
good.
Of add sort of look how the light's casting on it now. You kind of can see
what it's gonna
more,
do.
More sort of ringing art. Look at all those details in these lines. It doesn't look flattering to me.
Mm,
it looks nice,
you mean,
soft, and unison when it's printed in natural PLA.
Yeah.
So hey, there's some diffuser tips there, I guess.
Mm-hmm. All right, cool.
Yeah.
And of course, we have the filament, trinket, LEDs, all the tools, batteries.
The NeoPixel mini skinny strips are out of stock right now, but I think there are different density sizes that you can get.
I think we have.
Trinkets are back in stock, and the batteries are in stock as well.
Yep.
Yep.
And these come in a black PCB and a white PCB. I think I used the white one just to match the.
Cool.
Actually, no, I used black. On this one, you can sort of see it.
I found that it kind of doesn't matter depending on your application.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to see them bare, then I guess, black and white matter.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So there you go. Neo minis.
Yeah. I think it's a pretty cool project for anybody starting off, like in, as a school curriculum. It could be a nice project for that, because then you walk away with something you can wear, something you can show off.
That's right.
And you can continue editing it via code.
Look at these light paintings. Like, these are crazy cool. I think somebody in the the comments of the YouTube video is asking if these could work with POV, persistent vision.
Mm-hmm.
If NeoPixels aren't really that great at it, because they just don't have the right speed. Yeah. So you need something like Dot Stars, and we just don't have Dot Star Mini.
Not yet.
Things yet. But if you weren't looking to do letters and stuff, you could stuff in the regular one, and instead of getting four strips, you would put two strips.
Mm-hmm.
Of the regular NeoPixels, but rather the Dot Star NeoPixels, if you wanted to do some cool things. That'd be pretty neat for night painting. Like, imagine this being like a GIF, an animated GIF. That'd be really cool.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, we had some fun doing long exposure photography. Of course, you need a flash to do it. We did this with a DSLR. It almost looks like Pedro spelled out love. Like, yeah, that's cool. And then, of course, the hero shot is... well, really, the hero shot, I think, is Pedro here. He made, like, a face or something. It looks really cool. Like, these bands of light that are kind of surrounding him as a force field or some sort of, like, protection thing. I don't know. It's pretty cool. Obviously good for raves, yeah. But as a tool for light painting, you don't really think about that till you try it.
Mm-hmm.
Just rather nice. And, of course, since you have the color wheel animation going through, you get these... You know, you get a lot of different colors. So you get like yellow here. It's really, really cool. And with the purples and the reds, it's pretty dope. Yeah. If you've ever done light painting, it's rather fun because you don't know what you're going to get at some points. You're trying to get something, you get something else, right?
And just a thing we didn't cover inside the Fusion 360 file, it is editable. With minimal moving around of some of the ports, you should be able to turn this into like, I think last week we talked about using them as like, like ankle bracelets or like a
tornado
choker, yeah, for any like cosplay where a character has like glowing
armbands
or something like that. So super flexible in that term.
Yep.
So cool.
Good stuff.
That is the LED NeoPixel bracelet.
Sure, check out the video on YouTube if you haven't. Give it a like if you like it. And share it if you can share things.
Mm-hmm.
If you can share that, yeah.
Let's go ahead and jump into this week's work in progress.
Yeah.
Now you got a very cool little tiny.
Yeah, guys. Camera. Playground Express is hot off the press, hot off the reflow oven. I got this yesterday, and I started working on a closure for it. So the Circuit Playground Express is the Circuit Playground board that we all know and love, but it now has the Atmel SAMD21 chipset, which has SPI flash and. It basically lets you run CircuitPython or MicroPython, which is an embedded high-level language. Awesome stuff. So the goal with this enclosure was to make it really thin and expose all of the sensors and some of the inputs. So we got the buttons, the switch. Do you want to flip the switch? What does it sound like?
And last night on the desk of Lady Ada, you'd have seen Lamar adding a really cool speaker onto it, where she was actually playing music out of there.
Yeah.
Check that out.
Yeah, so you have access to the USB port and the JST. Look how massive that JST is. Like make it thin, rotate it thin-wise.
Oh, yeah.
The other way, like this. Rotate it. So you can see the thickness of...
I'm going to take this out so you can better see that.
Sure. Yeah, look at that. So it's 4 millimeters thick, which is really, really thin. And then I have exposed... every sensor except the temperature sensor, because it's just a resistor, which is like over there, yeah. So I have the reset button, the left and the right button, the switch, the little buzzer, the speaker, and the light sensor, which I still have to test and see if the diffusion of this. Did you guys notice that this is brown, but somehow it's being diffused? So this material is actually PLA, coffee PLA from Protopasta. They make coffee PLA. I think they're the only ones that make coffee PLA. And they make it really good. So it actually diffuses the light pretty well because it's semi-translucent. So if you look at the back, you can kind of see the detail. You can kind of make out the Circuit Playground. And I put a little face on there and just, why not? One of the cool things we did with the silk screen is that we added a little area so you can write your name on it, which is kind of neat. And I just figured I'd put a little face on it. Why not? Face case. But it's cool that it diffuses the light and gives you this nice, kind of makes the colors more punchy, I think. That's kind of neat. It's got good like contrast colors to it. So this is I'm actually planning to do a layer by layer on how I put together the enclosure.
Yeah, there's all cool little engineering designs that went into this. A little bit. The cool things about this is that it only prints in 7 minutes. So excellent for classroom. If you want to
each
customize.
Prints in 7 minutes, which is crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
So we've made like little bumpers and things like that for the Circuit Playground in the past. I remember the wearable Ninja Flex, little wearable
wristband
for this. Problem with this is, you know, not everybody can print Ninja Flex, and this actually takes 2 hours to print.
2 hours.
Yeah, so it's quite a while just because you have to lower the speed when you're printing a Ninja Flex.
Yeah.
None of those restrictions for, you know, regular PLA.
Mm-hmm.
On that. And really quickly in the chat room, Ryder, we did cover up the temperature sensor. No, I still work on it, so
well, it's a resistor. How do you... why would I expose a resistor? Do you touch the resistor? Is that how it works? I think it reads one of the pins, like A2, and then uses that to figure out how, you know, to read if it's hot or not. So, yeah, maybe I'll expose it. I don't know. Another option is to expose all of the SOAP pads, you know, the alligator pads.
Yeah, it's another version we're going to make,
So I need to make another version. But this one's just kind of like, okay, it's embedded. I can, you know, put it right here as a badge, or I can have it on a whatever... Mm-hmm. Arc reactor type thing, or
you can take all the solids for that and easily add.
Well,
like
it's got
a little
flat back, so you can like glue anything to it if you want as well. Mm-hmm. Maybe wear it. I don't know. Put little loopholes at the end, and then add a strap that's not 3D printed, like a metal one or something. So you can do a lot of different things with it.
Yep.
Cool. That's I'll release the file.
Progress, soon. And I'll probably make a video about this just because I think it's such a big deal having MicroPython on here. For a lot of you that don't know, you just plug it right in through USB and it shows up as a USB drive, which is pretty mind-blowing.
Yeah, it's awesome. So this Friday, Hackaday is having a little hack chat with Tony D and Scott, right?
Mm-hmm.
They're both going to be there talking about CircuitPython and some of the basics and stuff. And then, if you want to see it already, Tony put an hour-long video on all about CircuitPython. So you can see he's got all the boards up there. He's got the Metro, the Gemma that's coming out soon.
Oh my God!
Some
of
the M0 boards, like the Huzzah, and the ESP82, which is the Huzzah. Sorry.
Yeah. Once those come out, everybody be ready. There's going to be just a avalanche.
These are going to ship with CircuitPython.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yeah. Right now, you have to. I think with the Circuit Playground, you gotta get the Fermata firmware on there, and with the M0s, you gotta flash it with through the terminal or something. But they will be pre-installed coming soon.
Yeah. So check out this video you haven't already. Wow, a lot of people already have.
Yeah. Can't wait to redo a lot of the older projects that will definitely benefit from this because you're able to more easily update the code on there without any IDE. It's
epic. So check this out. Epic. If you go to the learning site. We have
quite a bit of projects already. Yeah.
Three guides on MicroPython. Paige, you put a little watch together using the OLED display. Tony's been porting a bunch of
libraries.
Yeah. So we got the CharlieFlex working. What else? We have the OLED display, the TFT displays, which is the ILI 9341.
That's a good idea.
Alpha numeric displays. DC motors. There's a lot to. What is this one? SD card data logging, SPI devices. Wow, so much Python. Great stuff. So check it out if you are interested.
It's a really good idea from Ryder over there saying to dual extrude the conductive pads on there. I'm gonna do that.
Oh, wow.
That's can't believe one. We didn't think of that.
Dual extrude, yeah.
All right, we will credit you for that.
No, that's a great idea.
Super great idea.
Wow. We'll give it a shot. It's a little challenging because dual extruding conductive material is normally a little pain.
Yeah, it works on the Sigma, on the
Ultimaker
3.
Because 3 is a little. All right,
at least the batch that we got.
On it. Cool.
All right, cool. Next up, we have. I think we'll save that for next week.
Yeah.
So if you guys haven't had enough of the fidget spinner, Noah came out with a CNC version of it. You might have
That's
seen
right.
it for this week's Milling Monday.
Yeah. Over the weekend, I thought I'd finally use this cheap piece of pine that I had laying around, and I milled the Adafruit Spinner logo with it using one tool, the 1/8 inch flat end mill. Yeah, you can do 3D milling on another mill, absolutely. I came up with the tooling strategies in Fusion 360 because it has integrated CAM, which is really nice. And here's the details. So I purposely didn't sand it completely, so you can still see some of the build lines and things.
Yeah, I hear the step.
Yeah. And then on the other side of it is the 3D printed version that's printed flat with concentric infill and 100 microns. So they're actually both 100 microns. So in Fusion, while making the toolpaths, I told it to do a fine step down of 0.1 millimeters, which is 100 microns. So it's the exact same layer resolution, which is pretty cool. And it took the same amount of time. So it took about 2 hours to mill, and it also took 2 hours to 3D print. So it's kind of interesting. It would probably take more time if I had a thicker piece of material or kind of I had to remove more material, but it worked out pretty well. So yeah, I think I milled at 800 millimeters a minute as the feed rate, because that's how fast it's like milling. So yeah, I think it worked out well. Some people were asking, well, okay, now let me see the bottom. Well, obviously the bottom's flat because, you know, you need a flat surface. And then, you know, you could make a jig where like it holds it down and then it mills the other side. Or you could just mill two of these and then glue them together. So I thought it was kind of fun to put these two halves together on the flat side and then have like one milled and one 3D printed. This is, of course, coffee PLA again. We've been printing so much with coffee. Like, just print everything with coffee and it looks better. It's great. So if anybody's interested in milling, if you guys have access to another mill, or maybe you're an educator with access to another mill and you're looking for some projects, hey, why not mill yourself a spinner? It's a great test in tolerances and 3D geometries. Pretty cool.
Yeah, it's one of the big advantages of the other mill is that you can do 3D CNCing, which definitely gives it a different depth and increases your skill level in terms of, you know, just cutting out, you know, regular 2D sort of stencil gets a little old after a while.
It's kind of easy too, like with adaptive clearing. It's like you just throw it on there and it figures out how to do everything for
super
it.
Cool. Yeah.
It's kind of neat.
Definitely recommended project for curriculums. Sure. Check that out.
Cool.
Ryder, I think, is saying, can the conductive filament actually do capacitive touch?
Absolutely.
Yes, it can. Yeah. So absolutely. There are some STL files that Protopasta actually put up. They made a gamepad with all of the pads using, you know, just conductive, and it works with a Makey Makey. It should work with.
So you use alligator clips to connect the pads to other pads.
Very cool. Yeah. And we actually made a video on that as well. If you want to check that out too, conductive filament. I forget the name of it, but the whole video was about using conductive filament. It can dual extrude with NinjaFlex, so it bonds perfectly. Should have made little holes on the logo. Oh, yeah.
Well, because of the spinner part.
It's kind of in the middle, yeah.
It
you kind of need that.
In the way, yeah. You can do that, though. Scoodle's asking, for pine, you could go faster but risk splitting. Yeah, that's true. You could go like 1,500 millimeters a minute, but I went with 800 just to kind of be a little bit quicker and you know. For the next part, I would probably mill it out of something like a hardwood, so like walnut or maple, hard maple. And then I would probably have to, you know, go slower. So I'd have to go like 400 millimeters. So, you know, and I'd have to turn down the roughing step down from 1 millimeter to like half that. So you do have to, as you get different materials, you do have to consider going down slower or speeding up depending on what you're doing. This was just a quick demo. I only had one piece of pine, which is funny, but it worked out well. I'm glad it didn't break anything or mess up the print. There was a lot of burrs and things that you saw in the video, in the milling video. There was a lot of burrs that I removed by sanding, but I didn't sand it completely, just so I can see those layer lines.
All right.
And paper's back.
Next up, comment in the chat room made me remember we just had a delivery of the updated palette, so we'll have to talk about that next week.
Really? They said palette?
Yeah. Okay. They wanted to learn more about the Ultimate 3 and the palette. Well, we just literally just now got the palette back in.
You just went out there and picked it up.
So we will talk about that next week. Yep. And I'll start on all of the tests for that as soon as the show's over.
Yeah.
But let's go ahead and jump into the web-based slicer generator for the BCN 3D Sigma pictures.
Sure. Let's check it out.
So about 2 weeks ago, I want to say we were talking about their new profile generator that they came out with. It was a Python script that would just run in the terminal. They updated this to be a web UI. Super simple. You can generate Cura and Simplify 3D versions that you can use as a nice baseline to get new firmware working with their updated profile. So it's super simple. You just tell it what nozzle size you're using and what material that nozzle is using, and that's pretty much it. You just download the profile from there and you're good to go. Did a really good job on this, and morning they updated the firmware yet again. Okay. They're doing it like every other day. So if you have a Sigma, definitely check that out on their GitHub repo.
Yeah, we'll have a link because it's on the Spanish version of the site, so it's in the US yet.
I don't think I've seen them tweet it out maybe once or twice.
How'd you find out about it?
I think it was like on their Facebook group where I saw them.
Right. And why would one want this? Why can't they just make their own profile?
Oh, because some of the definitions that they're using in there is optimizing the way that the motors are being controlled, so definitely recommended for that.
Sure. Are there any new start and end G-code
Yeah,
scripts?
There is, so you definitely want to take advantage of the generator for that.
Okay.
So check that out, and that bleeds into what we printed on the Sigma for this week's Time-Lapse Tuesday.
Hey, look! It's a little trophy.
Woo-hoo.
We were nominated for Top Designer at PinShape.com, and y'all voted for us. Thank you for voting for us.
Even though we told you not to vote for us.
Yeah. We didn't get the Amazon gift card. Somebody else did, so that's great. So this is a little trophy that they sent us, and we 3D printed it on the Sigma using gold PLA. Pedro, you kind of modified it, didn't you?
So I just hollowed it out, just took it inside of a mesh mixer, and just punched a hole through the top, and then hollowed out all the insides inside here.
It really took 10 hours to print. I'm sorry, but it took 10 hours.
Yeah, I really like the detail on this.
Well, why did it take 10 hours?
0.2 millimeter height and a 0.4 millimeter nozzle.
How fast are you printing?
60 millimeters a second, so...
10 hours.
Can't go any faster than that. The height of this is probably why.
Yeah.
But yeah, thanks everybody for voting out there.
Yeah, look, it turned out pretty good.
Yeah.
You can make out the text. Mm-hmm. It's nice.
Should we release this so people can make their own trophies to give away?
I'll ask and see.
I think it's a cool little design. Yeah. They have like a little, it looks like an Ultimaker, yeah.
Yeah, it's a little printer.
Little buttons here.
To me, it looks like a FlashForge.
Yeah. The rectangular shape makes it look more like an Ultimaker with the spool in the back. But good job. I don't know who designed this over at PinShape, but it came out really good.
Cool.
Thanks,
put some lights in it.
And then next up, we have the Ultimaker 3s.
Ultimaker
3s? Are finally
3s?
In stock.
What? We're late to the game. But hey, it's there. So if everybody's interested in picking up an Ultimaker, there's another place to get it. Adafruit Shop.
Ooh.
You can get 10% off and free shipping on this because it's over $200. Anything over $200 orders is free shipping for U.S. Continental stuff. But yeah,
here it is. Well, you're saving almost $400 with the 10% off. So if your institution...
$400 off? Wow.
Almost, yeah. It's like $375, I want to say.
Cool.
But they are in stock. We have plenty of projects that we released for them that you guys can check out. A lot of dual extrusion projects obviously print perfectly on there, and I think one of the coolest things is the firmware updates happen right on board. You know, just go over into the maintenance and hit update anytime there's something new come out. You know, you don't have to go to any website or anything like that. You don't even need your computer on. It just connects to the network and automatically downloads all that
I wish I had B-roll for that. Like, We need like a cool Ultimate Maker 3 video.
Well, we've shown that in past shows before.
Yeah, but this is now, and nobody's seen the past.
No. I don't know what this is on there. One of our other favorite features on it is the auto leveling. Actually works really good.
Yeah.
And then the, of course, the dual extrusion is very good, just because of the, it's able to lift the nozzle. And we have a whole video of that if you guys want to search.
I don't want to get into it now. That's funny.
But they are in stock. I know it's going to be a little pricey for a lot of you guys, but if you're in an institution or, you know, engineering job.
If you're looking for
that is
one
definitely
for your makerspace, you might want to check it out.
Yeah, it's definitely a engineer target market.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean,
But
we got a lot of the community was very vocal about that. Like, hey, why is it so pricey?
Well, people are saying, more quality equals more money. And just when you
operate
it.
As well.
Yeah, reliability of it. You instantly see just by operating that it is definitely cut above the rest in terms of it being aware of itself.
Mm-hmm.
So it's definitely worth it. Check it out if you are in need.
Scuttle ordered one in Europe and is still waiting on it. Cool.
Oh, wow.
Let's know how it goes.
Yeah, they take a while to build, actually. They have quite a bit of backlog on that.
Yep.
And then other things we wanted to talk about was the 3D printed adapter for the overcam. I'm still going to test this out for... Yeah, we'll talk about it next week then.
Hey, guys, we got a new overhead. You can't see it, but this is it.
It kind of blends in with everything over here.
It's nice.
You can kind of see it. I put my hand right here.
Yeah, normally we'd have this giant microphone stand, which has like a tripod leg, and then it would kind of come over this iMac.
Mm-hmm. We'll release the files next week, or probably later today, just because it's so handy. When we were looking for other tripods that actually do this better, they're always ginormous and clunky. We don't really need that.
Yep. Wish I could show it.
Let's go and jump over to this week's Community Makes.
Sure. All right, this is where we get to share your projects from the community. If you guys have any projects, you can let us know by hitting us up on any of the social channels up here. We have those social channels up there. So you can hit us up if you want us to share one of your projects. We'd love to take a look at it. So let me cue this up. And the first thing we want to show is actually from Mr. J. Wall, who goes by Print That Thing on YouTube, so check it out. He created a Wolverine claws, but the cool thing is, not just the claws, after this ad, he created like this this little hand grip. So he grabbed a piece of clay, and he formed it over his hand, and then he 3D scanned it using Remake, which is a piece of software from Autodesk, and cleaned it up in, I believe, Mesh Mixer or some other CAD package, and printed it out. So he optimized it for printing and sort of taking that real-world reference model and then printing it out to a one-to-one scale. So it fits his hands perfectly because, it is a form and mold of his hands. So that's pretty cool. So if anybody's looking to make kind of custom things like that, it's a great sort of technique and workflow. He also used Mesh Mixer to smooth it out. So check out J-Wall if you haven't already. Subscribe to him on YouTube. He makes great content, pretty cool designs. Print That Thing, J-Wall, send in the love.
Very cool.
Awesome. Next project is this one here. This is amazing. This is a quadruped robot, which is just like a thing of nightmares. I think it's awesome. I don't know.
They got Ghost in the Shell.
Remember Ghost in the Shell?
Yeah, of course they got that motion control on there. Really nice.
Yeah,
it's super smooth.
It looks like it's going to jump it on your face and just hug it. It's a face hugger. Using a NeoPixel ring. That's awesome. Yeah, so the whole, like, this is destructible.
Yeah. Best instructable that I think I've ever seen, just because it has of the parts linked.
Look at the quality of the parts.
For making one of these projects, being able to find all of the parts.
Yeah, here's all the parts. Weighing all the parts. Haku.
Doing the third insert.
How to do
thread inserts.
This is a guide, man. Look at this guide. So much documentation. This is awesome. They even have little animations and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
On like putting the threads in.
Yeah, he went. Oh,
that's dope.
Above and beyond and creating all of the
Taco Fritz
step files
on
for this.
Instagram, put the Instagram on Instructables. So check it out. I'll have the link for you guys in the below. And tomorrow we're gonna blog it up and code, of course. Love the code.
Wow, great so job!
Much.
I know.
Oh my god, I'm
so freaking cool.
It's so cool. All right, so I won't go through the whole thing. Just check it out. There's a video on it too.
Mm-hmm. I think that's it.
Hey, look, there's a screen launcher.
This one's pretty cool.
I got new ones for you. Sorry. This is cool. This is a string launcher.
It's so mesmerizing, just the way it works. Yeah. It looks like an infinite slinky shooter.
Yeah. Like,
it's because of the way that the string is forming when it shoots out. It looks so cool.
Why? Because physics and 3D printing.
I think it looks
and
cool.
Electronics. Why not? This is cool. Check it out. Just two motors, right? Yeah. I don't think there's even a microcontroller. It's just straight, like, on-off.
Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
That's pretty cool.
Let's check that out. Thingiverse user Falcon Physics. Great stuff. Looks like he's in a classroom. I hope he's teaching this in class.
Yeah, that's dope. Right.
Hey, how about making games, desktop games, on your 3D printer? This is Battlefleet Star Wars versus Star Trek. That's cool. Like, the whole game board was 3D printed, I believe. And the pieces, of course, were 3D printed. Yeah, the whole game board. It's crazy. Crazy cool. Next one is... I just like joysticks. I saw this joystick, and I clicked like button. I'm a simple man. Check it out. Hey, Raspberry Pi camera. This is one of the best Raspberry Pi camera cases I've seen because it has a built-in focus ring. Look at the focus ring. It's awesome. You just twist it to focus it.
Yeah.
How awesome is that?
We've been doing it wrong this whole time.
Yep, I've been doing it wrong. I have been shown the way. So check that out if you are looking to get quick access to the focus on your Raspberry Pi camera. I know I do. Last project, this is a little calculator using the Adafruit TFT display. I forget which one. I think it's a 2.3 or 2.4, rather. It's a Quackulator.
Quackulator?
Awesome. Yeah, Quackulator. That's pretty dope. I like the enclosure design. It's very, very thin, minimal. Here it is working. Let's check that out. It's like an old HP calculator. The little animation there is so dope. Yeah, it looks great. I just think it's cool. Put a phone in there and you get yourself a phone. I love the bezel. It's definitely capacitive touch because the bezel's black. You can tell. Hmm. Looks great, right?
Yeah, it's so just enough room for all of the buttons there.
Right. Yeah.
Very awesome.
Good stuff. All right, we'll have these projects linked below and on our blog post tomorrow. So check this out. Mm-hmm. And again, if you want your projects featured here on the show, you know how to do it. I'm going to tell you how to do it. Hit us up on one of these social channels or go to support.adafruit.com. What am I talking about? Emails, support@adafruit.com.
That will be the easiest way to do it because of the blog team can get that up and pin it up for posting. All the projects we talked about will be on tomorrow's blog. And if you haven't already, we do have an RSS feed. If you still use those,
you have an RSS feed?
Yeah.
What's RSS? Just kidding.
So let me check that out. And we'll jump into this week's Q&A.
Hey guys, Q&A time here on YouTube and Facebook. We'll try to scan both of them. So if you guys have any questions, anything that you want us to talk about.
Yeah, so Robert
like 5 minutes.
Is asking a discount code for today.
Really?
Neo Minis. Minis.
Yeah, a part of your balanced breakfast diet thing. Ha ha ha, see what I did there? Old HP Calc designed by Steve Woz? I did not know, Scuttle. Thank you.
Oh, wow.
That's awesome. That makes it even more epic. The things I don't know.
How's the quality of the Ultimaker 3? It's pretty good. Although, surprisingly, at 2.2 millimeter layer height, it doesn't look as good as the Sigma BCN 3D for some reason. You have to go down to like 150 microns.
You sure it's not the
part? No, I tested two parts and doing the dual extrusion too.
Wow.
So at 150 microns is when you get the really fine quality out of it. So just keep that in mind.
Want to know about the palette? Yeah. We're going to dive into it.
Yeah, it was just some of the ways that we're testing the motor calibration. You know, they just came out, so of course this is where all the fine tuning and setting adjustments is going to come into play. But we'll test it out. Open up the box, start it after the show. I'll let you guys know. And if you guys want to follow any of the behind the scenes, check us out on Twitter, Instagram. I'll be posting videos there.
Lloyd is asking if there is some sample code, RFID sample code, from Colin's lab project on RFID tags.
Might be the breakout one right there, NFC breakout.
Yeah, but specifically like the code that Colin used, I believe.
Oh, to edit the files?
Yeah, I'm not too sure. I'm looking at his guide.
The project that Becky did, I think it shows you.
All right. So go to the learning system and type in RFID. There are quite a few different projects, and I'm not sure which maybe it's a part, maybe it's a demo sketch that's a part of the library. I'm not sure. I haven't really done much RFID projects, but that's probably going to be your best bet, is to take a look at the RFID library in GitHub and then see if there is any demo sketches that are tied to, that come with it. Usually our libraries come with some nice example sketches, so check those out. Hope that's enough to help there. Hope that's something there. Okay, next question.
True Tech is saying that we need to create templates for the best settings for every 3D printer made. So we do have templates for all the printers that we've been testing that have come through our shelves here on the back. So if you go over to github.com/Adafruit/3D-printer-profiles. Yeah. Is the screen on there?
It is now.
You can check out every single printer that we have tested. Profiles on there, the old ones that we don't even have anymore, like the Taz.
Use them with a grain of salt, you know? Everything's different, so things change all the time. And
if the firmware changes, like the way that the motion driver is working or something like that, it is going to be off. So we have for the M3D, the Replicator 1, Sigma, Ultimaker, FlashForge, Orion, PrinterBot, Simple, the
Plus. I need to put my Play on here. I need to do that. Okay.
Orion, Type A.
Yeah. All of these fine printers, yeah.
Yeah. And more, because there's like sub versions of them as well. So they're all there if you guys want to check those out. It's all the settings that we use to successfully print a lot of the projects. So a very good baseline to work off of. When does the $150 mono price printer come out? Which rep wrap would you recommend? Taking into account, I don't have a printer right now. I can't print the parts. So the $150 mono price printer, is it the Delta one or the?
I believe it's the Delta one. The $200 one is the sort of Bowden type. Mm.
Well, one of our engineers has one and he likes it.
Yeah, Phil B.
Yeah, he was quite surprised that it actually, you know, he didn't have a high expectation, so definitely come in with that mindset anytime you're buying a cheap printer, and if it succeeds in your, in terms of the quality and everything,
Sorry, I'm playing
definitely
with these
recommended,
magnets.
Yeah.
These magnets are just, wow. I mean, magnets, how do they work?
Do we have any idea when the Ultimaker 3 will have smaller nozzle size cores?
We do not know.
I don't know, but I'm sure they'll send us some as soon as they are ready. I know they're working on it.
Be sure to leak that info as soon as we know.
They are working on a NinjaFlex core, which isn't secret. They say it on their site.
Oh, okay.
Under their the material section of the Ultimaker website. So they are working on it.
What happens to your old printers that you don't use anymore? I donate them to people that use them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yep. We gave one to Kirby, the Taz 4, and he fixed it up and.
Yeah. But you got to prove yourself though.
You can't prove yourself. No, I know.
You can't just ask for a printer.
I know Kirby's. Yeah, Kirby's.
You got to show your work and.
Kirby's an author on learn.adafruit.com.
Yeah, yeah, definitely check those out. He's working on some cool projects.
Yeah.
Would have some people come late? Different time zones. Everybody wakes up different times.
Yeah.
Have you guys seen the Anno printer using the phone screen? Yeah, we did an interview with them.
Yeah, we did an interview with the guys, some of the team.
I don't know when it's coming out or.
We don't know anything about it.
Supposedly, I think it should have been out already.
Yeah, it's been delayed already and we haven't heard anything from them.
But just like anything, there's always, manufacturing issues or supply. Chinese New Year is coming up, so everything is going to be shut down.
Sorry, guys.
In terms of like components and parts, so if you're looking to get some Adafruit parts, they're going to be out of stock for about a month.
Cool. Kirby got his left extruder, his Taz 4, which is now Taz 5, Hooked up with NinjaFlex. Oh, sweet.
Yeah, it actually performed very well when I tested out the NinjaFlex on the with the dual extruder. Has a nice retraction script when it's changing nozzles.
Matthew wants to know if we're going to make a Raspberry Pi case and put some nice RGB strips in it. We could. I haven't done that yet, actually. That's interesting. Hmm. Running NeoPixels on the Raspberry Pi, I think, is a little not as easy as Arduino. Yeah, we might have changed.
We do have a Matrix hat, I want to say. Okay. Those on top.
So maybe there's some nice cool. Libraries for it. Okay. Cool. All right, well, I gotta wrap the show up. I got
library. I want to test out this palette already.
You want to test out the palette? All right. Thank you guys so much for joining us today. We really appreciate it. If you did like this video, you could let us know by liking it, thumbs down, maybe share it on Twitter or one of your socials. Mm-hmm. That'd be really cool. Really appreciate that. And again, if you want to pick up anything from the shop, we got Neo Minis. Why is that so hard to say? It rolls off the tongue. I don't know why it's so hard to say. Hey, later tonight, if you guys want to come on the show and tell and show off what you're working on, we'd love to do it. We'd love to see it. It's today, tonight, at 7:30 p.m. Eastern Time. And then Ask Engineer is, of course, every Wednesday at 8 p.m. as well with Lamar and Phil. New products, Raspberry Pi, Arduino, and more. Mm-hmm. Tony D is on Fridays. Desk of Lady Ada is like every day.
It's so random, yeah. So far, it's been every day this week.
Pseudo Desk with
her out on all of the newness coming up on Circuit Playground and other unreleased products.
Yes.
Check that out. And then on Friday, special episode of Ask an Engineer with Andrew Bunny Hung.
Yeah.
Hangs out at the Adafruit Factory.
I don't have a thing for that other than this one.
Oh, yeah. We saw the episode already. It was super cool. He's very awesome. Yeah. Talks about a laptop. Talks about
some of the nuances.
The new phone, the encryption like detector thing for the phone that he's working on for Snowden. His book, a couple books actually that he's working on. Super cool show. Yeah. Definitely
and
do not
miss. And some new paper electronics. It's like
wow,
very cool.
Like some really
definitely
cool
want
stuff.
To check paper electronics that out. Is the next hotness.
Yeah.
Paper.
Oh, and what's so cool? I was thinking about this the other day. I was like, especially with the MicroPython showing up just as a USB drive on your computer. I was thinking, wow, because when we were out shooting the LED cuff video, we forgot to put the blinky code on there.
Yeah.
And I was like thinking, oh man, if only we could hook this up into our phone
and then change the code on the phone and then upload it to your phone. We can do that with Android, I believe, right? Or is that something
It needs a driver. I tried it out and it didn't work, but it does pop out and say, you know, hey, I don't have a driver for this.
Yeah.
On the on iOS, it just shows. It doesn't even power it. So.
Yeah.
But
iOS. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. Well, that's all.
I didn't get to the point why I was even saying that. The new circuit that Bunny is working on. It does work with a phone. Yes. We can edit that.
That's right.
And so definitely don't want
to
miss
that. And that kind of revalidated, like, this is a great idea. This is what we want to be able to do.
It's so cool. Very cool stuff coming up.
Cool. And a new video from John Park is coming out. I need a John Park slide.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So lots of coolness every week on Adafruit. Definitely share, subscribe, like.
Yeah. If you guys want to follow us on the social channel, they're over here. Mm-hmm. Again, thank you guys so much for watching. Hit that like button. And what does he say? Domination. Like, subscribe for the domination. We want you guys to dominate with us. So,
all right, guys.
Until next time.
See you.
Bye.